Well, there was two neighborhoods. There was the West Side. That's where me and Ronnie and Bob Burns, our first drummer, came from. And then there was Cedar Hills. That was like the big, cool part of town where you had a pool in your backyard and everything. That's where Alan came from. We all met in high school, and we played baseball. Here's a good story. The way we really started was Bob Burns was our original drummer, and me, we were best friends in high school growing up, and we played baseball. We were on the Little League, Pop Warner Little League team. So we were playing ball one day, and we went to see the big guys play, and they were the Green Pigs. That was the name of their... that was the name of the team, the Green Pigs, and Ronnie was on that team. We didn't know him at that. We knew of him because he was a badass and he could beat you up. And so after two or three innings went by, you know, we got bold and we went down on the field. We were in the dugouts. We knew everybody. So about the end of the game, we were right on the field with him. And Bob Burns was on the third baseline with the coach because he knew the coach. And we were watching the game. And Ronnie got up the bat and he went swung and missed. And then went bam and hit a line drive. Smacking the Bob Burns right between his eyes.
Oh.
Knocked him slap out. We thought he was dead.
Oh.
And Ronnie went running over there and went, oh, God, I killed this guy. It's terrible. We woke him. He finally woke up and, what's your name? And Bob, you know. So after the game, we said who we were. And I'm Gary and you're Ronnie and you're Bob. And we went, and Ronnie went, yeah, don't you play drums? And Bob went, yeah, he's still crying. He went, yes, I do. And Ronnie went, well, I sing. And he went, I was a little fat kid, second baseman. I was a real good ball player. And he went, don't you have a guitar? If you had, it didn't matter if you played or you were good. It's just if you
just
had
if
one.
Just if you had one.
And
you
went,
were cool.
Yeah, I got one. You know, I was still paying for it through my paper out. But I went, yeah, I got one. So we said, well, let's practice tomorrow. And then the next day... After we said, well, let's go rehearse tomorrow, or not rehearse, but let's go play tomorrow in your carport, because it was whose mother would let them play at their house.
That was very important.
That wasn't where you were going to rehearse, it was
or whether
mom,
you knew any the right licks.
I could talk my mother into it, so.
So you were cool.
And so we were driving down the road. Ron was the only one, he was 16 or 17, we were still 15. So he had his own car, and he was driving. So we were driving down the road, and here comes this guy on a purple Swin bicycle with butterfly handlebars, driving down the road 50 miles an hour, and Bob went, there's Alan. And we didn't even know Alan. He went, who's that? And he went, he got a guitar, too. He's got a guitar. And so we went, and slid on brakes on Lakeshore Boulevard. And Ronnie, like I said, he was a badass. He had a bad name. He had a reputation of being,
tough
if you
guy.
Said something bad to him, he'd beat you up, yeah. And he could do it, too. But anyway, we slammed our brakes and jumped out of the car, and Alan saw Ronnie, and he took off the other way. Man.
Oh!
And we had to chase him down in the car. And we went, Alan, and Bob, Alan knew Bob. He went, Alan, it's me. He went, when do you want to talk? So Alan stopped and went, okay. He was running. And so we went, hey, we're going to get together and play guitars and sing tomorrow. You want to do it? And he went, okay. And we wanted him because he was the only guy in town that knew Get Off My Cloud by the Stones. That was bar chords, see? We just knew regular folk chords. And so he was my hero because he knew bar chords. I don't even think he wanted to come the next day because he was scared he was going to get beat up. But he kind of got bossed into it. So, and you know what? He was in a band called The Mods.
Alan Collins.
Yeah. So we had to go over and threaten the Mods that we would whip their asses unless they could give Alan his amp and guitar back so we could practice. So we got together the next day in Bob Burns' carport, and we played, you know, Little Black Egg and Get Off My Cloud.
Oh, yes!
That and Louie, and, you know, yeah. We were hit. So that's the way it really started.
Lynyrd Skynyrd started on that ball diamond.
On that ball diamond with Bob Burns getting his headlights knocked out by Ronnie.
I ain't the one. I see that's you and Ronnie, right?
Mm-hmm. I never even told this in an interview. That's about a girl that came up to Ronnie and said that she was pregnant from him. And he said, I ain't the one who made you pregnant. You know, it was a girl who was with a lot of guys. And he went, I ain't the one. And if you listen to the lyrics, it tells the story. I ain't the one who's been messing with you and stuff. And her daddy wanted him to marry her because she was pregnant. And so he just wrote the song that quick. And I'd had the idea for the music. You know, like I said, we wrote all the time music, and Ronnie would put the lyrics to it. So that was just one of the little things. But it's the true story. All these are true stories. Ronnie always had a great gift of writing stories that meant something or were true or about his life or somebody's life. And everyone that he ever wrote was like that.
How did long hair fit in 1968 in Jacksonville, Florida, when you were just in high school?
It didn't. It didn't at all.
People kind of want to challenge you, think you were a sissy or anything like that?
Oh, yeah. We really got in a lot of fist fights, really, for having long hair. We used to play clubs, and the sailors would come out and wait for us because we had, I mean, long hair was like,
people that
like
were
touching your ears and
touching your
eyebrows.
Ooh.
That was long back then. That was when the Beatles were freaks because they had such long hair, you know. It was against school rules to have long hair then, so we put Vaseline and Brill Cream, a little dabby do you. We put the whole tube on before school. And we'd grease it back and plaster it down, and it would be good. All the teachers thought we had short hair, but then at gym, you had to take a shower. It was mandatory. You had to take a shower after gym. It was
right. The
rules. So we'd take a shower, and Lynyrd Skynyrd was our gym coach. That's Lynyrd Skynyrd, spelled right. And so he would walk through the showers every day, checking up on his students, and he'd see us taking a shower and see the Vaseline out of our hair, and it would touch our ears, it would touch our cheek, it would touch our shoulders, you know. But so he finally kicked us out, and he suspended us and kicked us out so long that we finally quit when I was 16. That was the legal age you could quit when you were 16, so we quit then because we were playing the church dances and the teen clubs and the clubs around town. And we had to be cool, man. And, you know, we had to be long-haired and look like an English group. And, you know, we came from British music. We listened to the Yardbirds and Clapton, you know, and Jeff Beck and the Beatles and the Stones and the Animals, all those groups. They were our idols and gods at that time. As a matter of fact, I swear, I really did think the Beatles were like gods. I had this thing when I was going to school. I would listen to the radio. I couldn't afford a record player then. I had a little radio. If they ever came on, I would never turn them off. And if I was late for school, had to miss school, or had to miss church, or get my butt beat by my mama because I missed a chore, if a Beatles song was on, it was like against my religion to turn them off. We were in it's a place in Jacksonville called W.D. West Tavern. And that's a bar, of course. So we went in there, and at the time we were 17, and you had to be 18 to get in. I mean, this was right the year the law changed to where you could be 18, not 21, to drink. And we were still 16, 17, but we, you know, how fake IDs were and stuff.
Were
so we could
business.
Get in this W.T. West Tavern. So we went in one day, me and Ronnie and Alan, I never danced my whole life. We always played so people could dance. I've never been able to. But anyway, this girl came over and asked Ronnie to dance because he was older, you know. So they went out and they started twisting and doing the monkey. And this guy come in and said, "Hey, man, that's my girl. You better get, what are you doing dancing?" And he went, "Hey, I'm just having fun." So we went right out 5 minutes after that. And the guy was big and bad, too. So he was like, you know,
now, wait a minute. Now, Ronnie had the rep of being the biggest baddest, so this must have been
Ronnie
Big John.
Ronnie wasn't big. Ronnie was little, but he was real mean, and he was a street fighter. He'd just soon pick up a bottle and cut you as look at you if in a fight, or, you know, he would always creep you. But he's like Leroy Brown, you know.
Yes.
He was a razor-toting guy, too. I mean, he'd cut you if you wasn't looking. Anyway, this guy, you know, he was really going to whip Ronnie for dancing with his girlfriend. They were in a little fight, and the only reason the girl was dancing with Ronnie because she was fighting with her boyfriend.
To get him
so
jealous.
So when
and
we
it
left,
worked.
And Ronnie literally said, he didn't say, "Give me 3 seconds." He said, "Please let me leave." And the guy pulled a gun and said, "I'm going to blow your brains," you know. And Ronnie went, "Please just let me leave. I don't know the girl. I don't want to see her again." And he turned around, and he didn't say, "Give me 3 steps." He said, "If you're going to shoot me, you're going to have to shoot me in the ass or elbows." And we started walking out the door, and me and Alan seen Ronnie walking, so we walked. And we got out the car, and we rode it, driving back to the house.
I was in a band called the Strawberry Alarm Clock, which I had formed in 67, back when I was 17 years old. So we did a tour of Florida, and our warm-up band in 1970, it was 1970, was Lynyrd Skynyrd. They, who had been playing together for a long time, but that was the first tour under the name Lynyrd Skynyrd. And matter of fact, I remember I did a diary of that tour, and I just pulled out that diary about 4 months ago and looked at it, and I spelled the name Lynyrd Skynyrd, the regular Leonard, right, L-E-O-N-A-R-D, and S-K-I-N-N-E-R-D. But Ronnie and I got along real well, you know, and they had just started writing their own material. When they opened for us, they were doing Led Zeppelin and Cream and stuff like that. I just told Ronnie, I said, you know, hey, if you guys ever need another guitar player, you know, I just want you to keep me in mind.
In 1971, Ed King found himself so devastated by the death of guitarist Duane Allman that he decided to move to the South to become immersed in what he saw as an up-and-coming rock and roll culture. In 1973, Leon Wilkeson decided to leave Lynyrd Skynyrd, and Ronnie Van Zant went looking for Ed King.
Ronnie calls me one afternoon, out of the clear blue. My mother didn't even know where I was, I swear. I don't even know how he found out where I was. And he said, hey, you know, our bass player just quit. Why don't you come join the band? Well, I was a guitar player, but I had, you know, I can play bass too, you know. And I said, wow, this is great. I don't have a car. He said, we'll be up 24 hours to pick you up. So Ronnie and Gary drive up in his little Toyota, right? And they picked me up with all my stuff and luggage, a little bit that I had, you know. And we drove back. And we started rehearsing. And we rehearsed every day, 12 hours a day, for 2-3 months. And I'd never been in a band that had done this before. It was like, you know, most musicians get up around noontime, but not Skynyrd, you know. Back in the days when they were hungry, they got up at 7 to be at rehearsal by 8.
You're kidding?
No, really disciplined, you know. I mean, they might get their rehearsal a little bit bug-eyed and kind of out of it, you know. But, you know, usually by 10 o'clock we were rolling, you know, and just go until the sun went down. We had a little farm that we rented at a little town called Green Cove Springs. We had a little cabin. It took a long time to get there. Once you, I mean, off the main road, it took you another 10 minutes to get back to the cabin. And it was right on a creek called McGirt's Creek. And we used to rehearse there, and one of us would have to spend the night out there every night because one time we had equipment stolen. People come up in a boat in the river and walk off with the equipment. And it was really freaky out there at night, all the, you know, snakes and roaches and sounds. You know, I mean, this is like swamp. It was the swamps, really, is what it was. So we'd practice out there literally 10, 12 hours a day. And at this time, they were teaching me some of what they thought was their best material, which, like, was Give Me Three Steps, I Ain't the One. Free Bird was one of the tunes we worked up, you know, and here I was playing bass and kind of disoriented, you know, because bass wasn't my instrument, and trying to really fit in some way on this thing.
In Lynyrd
we were playing Finocchio's Bar. And it was probably 1970 or 71. Anyway, we were just playing. We were a real big bar band in Atlanta. That's where we kind of made it out of. We had done all the clubs and stuff in Florida and Southern Georgia, and we finally made it up to Atlanta,
which was making it big in that part of the world.
Oh man, if you played Atlanta, you were big time, and you could retire the next week, you know. but we went up there, and we played clubs, and we'd played this place, Finocchio's, for, you know, 2 or 3, 4 months. I mean, a week, and then we'd leave. And one night we were playing, so we looked down there with Al Kooper in the audience, and we were playing, boy, and we saw him, and we went, hey, that's Al Kooper. We better play good, you know. So we started playing good, so he came up on the break and said, hey, you guys are real good. Will you play our next song, and I can record it and take it to my label? I want to start a record company called Sounds of the South, a subsidiary of MCA. And we went, sure. So he recorded us and flew to L.A. the next day and played it for all the guys way back when. And they liked us, and they kind of signed us, or he signed us to that label. But that's how it happened. And that same night, here's a little story you can add to your files, is we were walking out the door. It was one of them fight nights. And some guy, you know, started some trouble with us. And we got in a big brawl fight. And this guy got beat up, and we got beat up, and there was people thrown in jail. And Al Kooper thought, what have I done? He was pulling his hair out. And
well, Al Kooper came down from New York and bought a house in Atlanta and went looking for bands because he knew something was happening in the South. And he signed a band called Mose Jones, and he signed the Lynyrd Skynyrd Band. Out of Green Cove Springs, we worked up a song called Simple Man. And we went in. Now, that was not one of the tunes we played on the demos for Al Kooper. We went in the studio and said, Al, I want you to hear this tune. And we played it for Al, and he says, oh, I'm not going to let you guys record that. And Ronnie says, well, you got your car outside. Why don't you just go out in your car and go on home, and we'll just record it here without you. And Al said, well, you guys can't do that. And so Ronnie escorted him out to the car. He said, you either get out right now or we're going to have some trouble. So Al Kooper left, and we stayed there that night and recorded Simple Man all by ourselves. And it turns out, to my, you know, this day, it's my one of my favorite Skinner songs of all time. You know, and I think even now it's one of Al Kooper's favorites. You know, he came back and ended up playing organ on it, you know. But everybody makes mistakes.
The way we always wrote in the Skinner days was me and Alan would either write a few chords and say, Ronnie, here's the lyric. I mean, here's the music. Write some lyrics. Or he'd come out of the shower or something and say, hey, here's the lyrics. Write the music. So at that this one song, Simple Man, I had the chords. And we had just gone through a little period in his life. He was married once and had a little girl. And he was getting divorced at the time. And I was going through a time in my life. I was like 17 then. I was old.
Big guy.
I was going to leave my mother's house and move into an apartment, you know, and leave. And it was real. And we were really depending and listening to our mothers. It's really, truly about our mamas and what they had told us. And what line he couldn't do, I'd say, hey. And my mother said this. And he'd go, well, my mother said this. And I go, well, my mom, you know. And it came out like in 5 minutes the song was written. You know, actually, except for maybe one, we had them all. We had been together for so long that we had them all written. We had worked for years and years and years, like I say, in club bands, and we were writing our own music. Some of that time, we had written all these songs, and Freebird was like 5-6 years old when we recorded it.
Are you kidding
me? Actually, we had that song. Alan Collins wrote the music to it. He wrote the beginning. I wrote the end, but he wrote that beginning like 5 years before Ronnie could write lyrics to it. Ronnie always said, hey, there's too many chords. I can't write words to that many chords. And then one day, Ronnie went, hey, play them chords again. And he started going, da 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 da, you know, and he went, I can write. So he wrote the lyrics to Freebird, and we wrote the end, and we kind of let it go.
Alan Collins' Freebird guitar solos became nothing short of legendary, the highlight of every Skynyrd concert.
We just were playing, man. We were into it, and
hey, cue up,
and it was never patterned. Okay. It was like a one night we'd do it 5 minutes, the next night we'd do it six, the next night we'd do it three, the next night we'd do it 10, and there's been nights we've probably done it 20 minutes, but it's a unique song, and I'm real thankful for it anyway. I can't say enough about that. I mean, there's a million little stories about that song. That's sliding piano, we went, oh, that's cool, and then we added Alan and all the end, and Now when we're 35 years old and it's hard to play
up.
Right now, boy, you gotta really get into it to play. Back then it was like warming up, but now it's a chore, but you know, that's all right.
When it came time to record Freebird for the album, the dilemma was obvious. Now, how do you take a song that runs 15 minutes or longer in concert and make it short enough for radio stations to play it? Lynyrd Skynyrd didn't try.
It was weird, you know, because back at that time, everybody said you had to cut 3-minute songs or 3.5, 4 minutes was the tops. or that you didn't get no airplay. And
they were right.
Yes, and we cut this song 9 minutes, and live it's 15, but on studio cut was 9, and they went, no, this song will never get airplay. You can't do it. You can't. Please rewrite it. Please restructure. And we.
When you said we, was that the
producer
band. Or record company?
Well, it was the producers and the managers and everybody in the whole world but us. And we thought, this is the song we wrote and meant and from our hearts. And but, you know, we were told it would never be. And we said, well, we don't care. It goes over good live. You know, it's a good live song. And we don't care if it, you know, you can play the other ones for radio. But we want this one. But this is it, and we weren't going to change it. We were, you know, Southern redneck rebels that we weren't changing our ways. Hell no, we ain't forgetting either. But we wouldn't change it, so it's a different time now. It's a different era.
Very much so.
And people said you couldn't do it, and they really didn't think that you could do a slow song, a ballad, so to speak, and then end it with a wild, crazy, frantic LSD type ending. You know, that's what we were told. Why are you doing that, you know? Why don't you just play a slow and quit it? And we just went, well, that's kind of like the free bird soaring off, being free at the end. And we got a lot of comments about that. But the biggest one I remember for joking prosperity's sake is how you can't write a song that long and never get airplay. And it's still one of the most played songs, I think, around. And
I think it probably always will be.
And it'll still get,
I
think.
And that's a pretty safe bet.
Yeah, it's going to be played. And, you know, we're sorry we wrote it so long, radio stations, but, you know, call my mom about her.
I remember when we were recording Freebird, you know, how we usually record songs was we lay down the rhythm track first, which would be bass, drums, and one guitar. And then you start overlaying other rhythms, other lead parts. And as Freebird was developing, I had always heard Freebird from the player's point of view, just playing it. But as I saw it now developing on tape, it took on a whole different appearance to me. I started to get an idea that it was really, it was a classic tune, you know? And I had no idea it would become the anthem, one of the anthems of all time. But I could remember these people walking in the studio, like the owner of the studio walking in and going, you know, wow, that tune is destined to become a classic. You know, history was being made, and none of us really believed it like we really couldn't believe it could be happening to us. He was the engine, you know. The band was just feeding him ideas. You know, fortunately, we had three guys in the band who could come up with the right guitar riffs that would inspire him to write. And I mean, between Gary, Alan, and myself, we all had three separate styles, wrote three different guitar ways, you know. So when we got together with Ronnie, the results were so diversified. It was, you know, the tunes were quite different.
And Gary Rossington.
The only people that ever did before that time was the Buffalo Springfield. But we didn't copy them, of course. We never sound like them, but they were the only group that had three guitars.
I never thought of that. Good point.
And Ed, with the Alarm Clock, they used to tour together, Alarm Clock and Springfield. And actually, that's where we first saw the Alarm Clock, was on the Springfield tour. We just decided since they had it, we could have three guitars. So lots of groups now have three guitars. We tried to structure the songs where they all interlocked, what, like the rhythm parts and the leads, and they kind of all fit each other. And it took us like weeks to do this when we first started. We didn't just start, you know, playing all together and playing the same thing. Everybody had their own part and their own style. Like Ed has his own way of playing, and Alan had his own way. And I got my own way, and that's the only reason it worked, because we all were so different, we could fit. We couldn't play. I couldn't play what Alan could play, and I couldn't play what Ed could, and they couldn't play what I could. You know, we couldn't copy each other.